Don't forget to subscribe and turn the notifications. We upload daily, and check the source of this video to view all the images and videos if there was any. Why do most of the good singers and groups have to be left-wing sympathizers? Country Music Nation is reporting that after finding out that President Donald Trump is still using his music at political rallies, Aerosmith's lead singer Steven Tyler has decided to take matters into his own hands. At a Trump rally in West Virginia on Tuesday, August 21, Aerosmith's 1993 hit song, Livin' on the Edge, could be heard blaring from the arena's speakers. The scene in WV before Trump's rally. Aerosmith's Livin' on the Edge. Playing. pic.twitter.com/hw1qr9tabage. Jim Acosta, at Acosta, August 21, 2018. Trending, immigrant actress says she'll leave the U.S. and not just because she hates Trump. Tyler immediately called up his attorneys and had them draw up and send President Trump a cease and desist letter through his attorney Dina Lapolt. The letter accused the president of willful infringement in broadcasting the song, This Is Not About Dems Versus REPUB. I do not let anyone use my songs without my permission. My music is for causes, not for political campaigns or rallies. Protecting copyright in songwriters is what I've been fighting for even before this current administration took office. Steven Tyler, at IamStevent, August 22, 2018. Steven Tyler already told Trump no before in regards to his song, Dream On, back when candidate Donald Trump was using it during his 2016 presidential campaign, and the singer personally told the then Republican candidate, Donald, you can't use Dream On, that's for causes, not campaigns. Trump then kept using his song and Tyler ended up suing the president. Here is more on this issue via the legal artist. Let's clear this up first. Using a copyrighted song without a license is infringement, even if it's for a non-commercial, political reason. Songs generally have many copyright owners, the writers, musicians, record label, licensing houses, publishers, etc., and that means you need several licenses, not just one. The RIAA has a useful primer illustrating a campaign's legal responsibility when licensing music. Here are some highlights. When music is played in public, such as at a campaign event, it is typically necessary to obtain a license for the musical composition, words and music. It is not necessary to obtain a license from the owner of the sound recording, usually a record label. A campaign must obtain permission from the owner of the musical composition, usually a music publisher, such as ASCAP, BMI, or SESAC. This is known as a sync license. If a campaign wants to use a specific recording of the song, e.g., Survivor's recording of Eye of the Tiger, then the campaign must obtain permission from the owner of the sound recording, usually the record label. This is known as a master license. ASCAP has its own primer, stating, if the campaign wants to use a song as its theme, they should contact the management for the artists and or songwriters of the song in question and obtain their permission. So you need permission, and fair use, an oft-claimed but little understood doctrine, won't give you relief either. As this Loyola of Los Angeles Entertainment Law Review article points out, using a song without permission for a political campaign typically won't qualify for fair use protection because the use of the music is rarely transformative, despite the fact that political campaigns are not commercial, the song's meaning is rarely altered, commented upon, or otherwise changed enough to differentiate itself from the initial use, the use of the music, often to bolster a candidate's standing in the eyes of supporters and or to bash other candidates, does not serve the public interest and is therefore not worthy of free usage, and if the music is used repeatedly, it could create a financial harm to the artist who would have otherwise been paid if the music had been properly licensed. But let's not kid ourselves, this is not a copyright issue. Copyright is merely the mechanism by which a musician can get the candidate to stop and or pay damages. This is about politics. There's a reason you rarely see musicians going after Democrats. After all, they don't endorse conservative candidates and they don't want their fans thinking they do either. And when we talk about an endorsement, we're really talking about the artist protecting his or her brand. And that falls into the realm of a trademark. Artists, especially established ones, rightly view their reputation as a business asset. If people like the brand, they buy the product. If the brand offends them, they don't buy the product. A good brand gives you not only money, but influence. That's how Taylor Swift is able to force Apple to change its policy with a single blog post. So when artists perceive their brand to be under attack, they understandably lash out. Trademark law can give them the tools to do that. Under the Lanham Act, the law governing trademarks, trademark infringement can occur if the use of a song by a politician is likely to create confusion asterisk in the marketplace that the musician endorses the politician, especially if this association harms the musician's reputation, referred to as dilution by tarnishment. But meeting this bar isn't so easy. To determine whether a likelihood of confusion exists, the federal courts have developed an eight-factor test called the Sleekcraft Factors, after the landmark 1979 Ninth Circuit case, AMF, Inc. v. Sleekcraft Boats. Those factors are the strength of the mark, the proximity or relatedness of the goods, the similarity of the marks, any evidence of actual confusion, the marketing channels used, the degree of care customers are likely to exercise in purchasing the goods, the defendant's intent in selecting the mark, and the likelihood of expansion into other markets. A quick perusal of the list shows why there's been so little litigation on this topic. There are a lot of factors and it's hard to meet them all. And that's because most people don't confuse usage of a song with a political endorsement. In other words, they don't assume Rem supports Trump even when the songs play prominently during his rallies. We all know that musical taste is not determined by one's political leanings, people just like the music they like. That's all there is to it. Here's a bit of truth for you. I find Ted Nugent to be one of the most repugnant human beings alive, but I still haven't found a better song to exercise to than Stranglehold. That's why artists are generally content to play the copyright infringement card or are satisfied with bad-mouthing the candidate. They definitely have legal options, but they butt up against the harsh reality of the situation, which is that no one cares if a Republican uses a pop song during a campaign. No one is denouncing Rem just because Trump used their song, and if they actually did, well, they probably weren't going to buy REM's record anyway, were they? The article above clearly explains the law when it comes to this. But what really makes me wonder is if Steven Tyler would be putting up such a fuss about the use of a song that is over a quarter of a decade old if it were Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders who were using it. The truth of the matter here is that in a way Steven Tyler's position is understandable. Aerosmith really hasn't had much to show for itself after the mid-90s. And they still need to live, so it's best they aren't seen as partisan, but all this whining by Tyler is still bound to produce animosity with people on the right. People who tend to buy albums, especially oldies.